My dear brothers and sisters, I want to start by asking all of us a question. And I want you to take a few seconds, because we don't have time for more than a few seconds, to try to guess an answer to the question I'm going to ask before I will expand on the answer, inshallah. And the question is, do you know of something that encompasses all evil, and all of us are prone to fall in its trap? And that question is, according to Islamic literature, according to Islam, what is that thing that encompasses all evil and all of us are prone to fall in its trap? Answer is bad temper. Bad temper, translated into Arabic, is al-ghadab. Al-ghadab, as reported in Islamic literature, I found, is not to be translated as anger. Because all of us, including Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, got and get and will get angry. And a person who does not get angry should consult a psychiatrist. There's no person who cannot get angry. There are things that pass in front of us that should make us angry. And if we don't, there's something wrong. But the question that is being asked and we are warned against is our inability to deal with anger, with the possibility of its transformation into bad temper, losing our ability to deal with anger, and then this bad temper will bring us close to shaitan. As reported by Abu Dawood, and it is a hadith that is reported in hadith literature as marfu', meaning that it is reported all the way to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. الغضب من الشيطان والشيطان خلق من نار. Losing one's temper is the result of shaitan working on the person. And remember, shaitan is created of fire, meaning that this fire, in a symbolic fashion, will lead the person who loses his temper into what fire does. It burns, it destroys, it creates havoc. Nobody wants to jump into fire. But this is what anger does. أَلَمْ أَعْهَدْ إِلَيْكُمْ يَا بَنِي آدَمَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ وَأَنْ اعْبُدُونِي هذا صراط مستقيم ولقد أضل منكم جبلا كثيرا أفلم تكونوا تعقلون. As we read in Surah Yasin, didn't I, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling all of us, didn't I warn you against, here it is mentioned, worship shaitan, but it means to follow shaitan without questioning. And there are many people, through their actions, through their words, through their looks, through everything, appear as if they are worshipping shaitan. And Allah is telling us, he is clearly an enemy to you. And I told you, Allah is saying, to worship me, to follow me, to follow my orders sometimes, even if you don't understand why, but follow me. I am your way of safety. Yet there are people who allow themselves to jump to the side of shaitan. وَلَقَدْ أَضَلَّ مِنْكُمْ جِبِلًّا كَثِيرًا. Can't you read throughout history? Can't you see in front of you how many people are misguided because of the deeds and influence and temptation of shaitan? Beware. And Mufassirun, exegesists of the Quran, said that this ayah refers mostly to the act of anger. To the act of anger. وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يَقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَنْزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ كَانَ لِلْإِنسَانِ عَدُوًّا مُبِينًا. As we read in Surah Al-Isra, the same thing. The same thing. Tell, Ya Muhammad, my servants, to say the best of things. Be careful what comes out of that mouth. Because shaytan yanzaghu baynahum. Shaytan wants to bring any two people or any two groups, put them against each other so that they can fight with one another, and then shaytan will feed into this group and into that group, and then they will end up pleasing shaytan and displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can we relate to that already? Don't we see, and this is a sad reality, statistics were shown who among all ethnic groups is the most prone to anger, and those who are least prone to anger, those who do not get angry. Now, they use certain codes and they use certain criteria. It happened to be that Swedish people are the least angry. Some people may argue because their life is easy. That's why they don't have to get angry. Now, without mentioning the specific ethnicity, so that nobody will get angry at me, because this is not my statistic, I won't say it. But, the most angry people are people from the Middle East. I'll leave it at that. We, and I'm from the Middle East myself, we get angry very quickly. And even when we want to greet each other, we yell at each other. We say it loud. And by the way, close second to people from the Middle East are Chinese people. Now, people may argue, but this is a reflection of the lifestyle. And the answer is, but we have Islam. Islam teaches us how to deal with the potential of getting from anger to bad temper. And this is what I wanted to discuss with us today, because we've been suffering the outcome of bad temper. What's the outcome? Very quickly, because we don't have time to expand on this. First of all, the outcome is on the tongue. What we say, bad temper resulted many times in divorce. And there are many people who come and ask, does divorce, when the husband is really very angry, does it pass? And my answer, not because I wanted to belittle the seriousness of divorce, but I say, tell me if there is someone who divorces his wife while reclining on his chair and say, honey, please come, I want to tell you something, you are divorced. Does this happen? It never happens. It's always when one or both of them are boiling and one or both of them lost their temper. Also, many parents invoke the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their children. Allah kaza, Allah kaza, Allah yaghdab, Allah kaza, all kinds of things on children. And then Once we calm down, we regret every word we said. We also invoke the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on ourselves. Allah ya'di alayhi, Allah yamarwidni, Allah kaza, all kinds of things. And once we calm down, we wonder, what happened? Why did I do all of this? Why did I say all of that? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in two places of the Quran, one of them in Surah Al-Isra, that be careful. Because sometimes if your dua happens to be at the time of ijabah, at the time when it is answered, it will be answered even though, oh, but I didn't mean it. وَيَدْعُ الْإِنسَانُ بِالشَّرِّ دُعَاهُ بِالْخَيْرِ وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. We always like to empty that thing which is inside us. We want to get rid of that extra adrenaline that we gave in our body, but you can't empty it. It has to take its time. And when we react as the result of that extra adrenaline that we secreted in our body, it may be too late. It may be too late. وَيَدْعُ الْإِنسَانُ بِالشَّرِّ. There are people who make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invoking evil, even on themselves, on their children, on their spouses, on any and everybody. The same way as when they make dua for good things. They sound the same. Because we just love immediate results. Someone who did something wrong, we want to see our wish come true on that person who wronged us immediately in front of me. It doesn't work that way. And we shouldn't expect that. Ibn al-Qayyim, in his book, Zad al-Ma'ad, says something. وَلَمَّا كَانَتِ الْمَعَاصِي كُلُّهَا تَتَوَلَّدُ مِنَ الْغَضَبِ وَالشَّهْوَةِ. He said, وَلَمَّا كَانَتِ الْمَعَاصِي كُلُّهَا تَتَوَلَّدُ مِنَ الْغَضَبِ وَالشَّهْوَةِ وَلَمَّا كَانَتِ الْمَعَاصِي وَلَمَّا كَانَ الْغَضَبُ يُؤَدِّي إِلَى الْقَتْلِ وَالشَّهْوَةُ تُؤَدِّي إِلَى الزِّنَا جَمَعَ اللَّهُ بَيْنَ الْقَتْلِ وَالزِّنَا فِي سُورَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ وَفِي سُورَةِ الْإِسْرَاء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Isra, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. And then immediately after that, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَمَنْ قُتِلَ مَظْلُومًا فَقَدْ جَعَلْنَا لِوَلِيِّهِ سُلْطَانًا فَلَا يُسْرِفْ فِي الْقَتْلِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ مَنْصُورًا. Immediately, because they are related to each other. So Ibn al-Qayyim said that all of sins, and when those people talk, they do not exaggerate. They say it as they learned it, that all of sins are derived from two sources. Temper or bad temper, and from animalistic desires. We want to satisfy our desire. We want, and because bad temper in its ultimate form leads to murder. In its ultimate form leads to murder. And animalistic desire may eventually lead to adultery. Because they are interrelated, and this is what Ibn al-Qayyim said in Zad al-Ma'ad, he said, because of that, Allah knows best. Allah made them one after the other in two surahs, Surah al-An'am and in Surah al-Isra. Now another outcome of bad temper, not only on the tongue, but on all our organs. Because when we look at somebody who had lost his temper, that person is sweating, that person has a red face, that person is shivering, that person wants to get at the person who made them angry and may harm that person, may hit that person, may hold that person and hit him against something, may do, and if stopped from doing that, he will start to hit himself. He will start to hit his head against something solid. He will start to tear his clothes. And I'm taking this to the extremes that all of us are familiar with. Because losing one's temper is not easy. Let us not forget what I started with. And I'm coming to something where I derived that. It is the thing that encompasses all evil. All evil, I will come to that. Not, these are not my words. This is from Islamic literature based on a hadith reported by Al-Bukhari, Al-Tirmidhi, and Ahmad. But going back to the outcomes that we see on the body, we know that it is not good. It can result in murder. And if not in murder, it can cause physical harm. And we know scientifically that people who get into bad temper, outbursts, often that affects the viscosity of the blood. They may actually have strokes because of the continuous production of adrenaline, and adrenaline causes the blood to move very fast, and that will cause outbursts in the brain. It can also cause deposits, fatty deposits on the walls of arteries, and that causes heart attacks. It can cause ulcers because of increased acidity in the stomach because of anger, because of adrenaline. Adrenaline raises the acidity in the stomach. It can cause imbalance in salt distribution in the body, and that affects the kidneys. And that's why we have heard in the past that people who lose their temper, so many bad things happen to them. And ask yourself, as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted our deen to protect us, not to keep going just like this and react. Wallahi, it's becoming something that is worrying all of us, that we Muslims are settling our differences through bad temper. We are unable to deal with the nasiha of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is where now I can't hold it any back. And we've heard it many times. Bukhari reported through the authority of Abu Hurairah, a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ya Rasulullah, awsini, give me an advice, something that, you know, I will learn from." He told him, "La taghdab, don't lose your temper." He said, "Okay, give me another advice." He said, "Don't lose your temper." And he kept repeating because he wanted something else. He thought, that is the man, that he wanted something real that he can do. But he kept hearing from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam the advice of don't lose your temper. And At-Tirmidhi reported the same episode but slightly differently, also through the authority of Abu Hurairah. A man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, probably it's another man, same man, it doesn't matter, but it's the same thing. And he said, "Allimni wala tukthir alay la'alli a'iyahu." Ya Rasulullah, I'm a man with limited ability to comprehend things. So teach me something, give me an advice, but don't give me something big. I want something quick that I can learn so that I can do it. I don't want something too big for me. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him the same thing. He said, "Don't lose your temper. Don't lose your temper." Now, where did we get that bad temper encompasses all evil? We get it from the report of Ahmad. When Ahmad reported the same story, the man who asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Wallahi, lama sami'tu min Rasulillah إلا أنني ظننت أن الغضب يشمل الشر كله. But because of what I heard, I felt at that moment that bad temper encompasses all evil. And now, for the last 1400 years, and even before that, you know, when Qabil got angry and lost his temper, he committed the first murder in human history. We know how many families got broken and continue to be broken, continue at an alarming rate because of bad temper. How many partnerships were dissolved because of bad temper? How many people stopped coming to the masjid because of bad temper? The imam said something that made me very angry, or one of the board members said something that made me very, and I say very angry, bordering on bad temper, because again, we've got to be angry when we see certain things. Rasulullah saw certain things that made him quite upset. And time does not allow us to go into the many examples that many of us are familiar with when he really got upset. But we are talking here about losing our temper. Losing our temper. And too quickly now, because time is time, it flies. I have to say that it affects our tongue, it affects our body. And number three, it affects the social fabric of our society. Even our deen is being divided into groups and subgroups because of bad temper. Because of bad temper. So what shall we do about it? Inshallah, we will point that in the second khutbah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Very quickly, I would just remind us with a few episodes to show how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and others that we know dealt with bad temper or with anger. We know the story of Imam Ali bin Abi Talib in the battlefield when he was fighting in the battlefield and he was about to finish one of the enemies. And that person spat at that pure face of Ali bin Abi Talib. Immediately, Ali bin Abi Talib let go of that man and went to another person. And many of the companions saw Ali bin Abi Talib, the student of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the husband of his daughter. You know, the one who learned Islam from early age and embodied that learning of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When asked, why did you do that? He said, I was about to kill him in the name of God because he's an enemy that I was ordered to kill. But when he spat in my face, I almost lost my temper. So I did not want to do what I was about to do because of that. So I let it go. Because I don't react as per bad temper. Another story is again, you know, related to two different people. Al-Bayhaqi related that to Zayn al-Abidin, Ali ibn al-Husayn, and other people of hadith related that to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. And the story related to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, it says that he once asked a servant of his to pour hot water because he wanted to clean himself. And as he was pouring that hot water, it splattered, and that hot water came on his face, and it really hurt him. So that servant realized that he wasn't careful enough. So he reminded him of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran. When Kalthimin al-Ghayb, he told him, he said, okay, I'm going to hold back my anger. He said, وَلْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, and those who forgive me, he said, I forgive you. And then he said, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. He said, Allah loves those who do extra good deeds. He said, go, you are free for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, we know also one time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his wife Salama, and this is reported by Nasa'i through the authority of Salama, she said that once I brought some very nice food I cooked, and there were companions at the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with Aisha. He was with Aisha that day. So she brought food. Now Aisha got jealous. She didn't like that. So she came and she took a stone and broke that plate that Salama brought. Now, imagine that this happened with you. Somebody did that on purpose. You will just lose your temper and you will take that plate and you will break it on the head of the person who did it. Okay? What did Rasulullah do? He went to the two pieces, took them, and then asked his wife Aisha to bring another plate, took the food, put it in that plate, they ate it. When they finished, he sent that plate with food from Aisha to Salama. And when that happened, all he said is, Kulu gharat ummukum. That's it, three words. He said to the companions, let's eat. Your mother got jealous. Okay, it's something that happened. So let's eat. And he did not lose his temper. And another time, you know, it was reported by Ahmed through the authority of Anas ibn Malik that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking and a Bedouin came and he pulled him from the back of his thawb. And it was a thawb that was really rough. It almost suffocated Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that Bedouin, you know, snatched him, turned him, said, Ya Muhammad, give me some money from that which you claim God gave you. أعطني مما أعطاك الله. Another person would have told his companions, take care of him. And you know what that means. Okay? But instead, he just said, okay, give him some money. And he continued and he was smiling. Now this is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now let us just go very quickly over that which we should do. Number one, وَإِنَّ يَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغٌ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. Remember these things. You get to the point where you are losing your temper, say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. In Surah Al-A'raf, إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. In Surah Fussilat, إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. The same thing. If you feel that shaitan is about to take hold of you, then say, I seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Satan. فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. And then the other thing is, and I'm sorry, I'm not going to mention the ayat and the hadith because of the time. Number two, mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, Subhanallah, la ilaha illallah. Just remember, one, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Number two, Subhanallah, la ilaha illallah. Just remember that. And then things will calm down, inshallah. Number three, remember this. Remember this because it's easy. Number three is, if you were losing your temper through yelling and screaming, stop talking. Stop talking. Withdraw all words. Just appear as if you are a fool in front of the person who's fighting you. Just stop talking. Stop talking. That's number three. And number four, go and make wudu and pray two raka'at. Ibn Abbas was on a journey and he received the news that his brother Quthan passed away. He was so close to Quthan. So أَنَاخَ رَحِلَتَهُ إِلَى جَانِبِ الطَّرِيقِ. He just went to the side of the road, stopped there, and then he made two lengthy raka'at. Because he was upset. He was angry. He was, you know, not angry at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was angry that he did not see his brother. And so he just made two raka'at. He prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number five, if you are standing, either sit down or lie on your side. And people say, what? You know what? Because when you are standing, you have more tendency to attack. But when you sit down, you cannot do that. Can you fight a person while you're sitting down? You can't do that. So if you are standing, go and sit down. Just sit. And stop talking. And say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajeem. Subhanallah, la ilaha illallah. And then go and make wudu. And then pray two raka'at. And inshallah, your bad temper will be taken care of. Enough is enough. Honestly. You know, we don't want this to be a label. Oh, he's a Muslim? He has a bad temper. Let's stop that, please. And next time statistics are collected, let's beat the Swedish. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وخطايانا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم علمنا من ديننا ما جهلنا وذكرنا منه ما نسينا وكن معنا ولا تكن علينا عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله اكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون واقم الصلاه الله اكبر